Thank you. Hola. Buenas tardes. Wow. What a crowd. Wow. So my name is Guy Kawasaki, and I'm going to talk to you today about the lessons that I learned from Steve Jobs. Okay? I'll show you a picture. So this is a picture of the Macintosh division, about 1984. I'm in the upper left corner. You cannot see me. One of the big mistakes that I made in my career is that I didn't stand in front of this picture. The person who really counts in this picture is Steve Jobs. He's kneeling in the front. That's the only time I ever saw Steve Jobs kneeling for anybody. So this is the collection of the Macintosh division. I worked for Apple from 1983 to 1987. I was Apple's software evangelist. My job was to convince people to write Macintosh software and to create Macintosh hardware products. This group of people was probably the largest collection of egomaniacs in the history of California. We held the record for about 30 years. Facebook recently broke the record, but we had the most egomaniacs. Back then, in Apple, there was the Apple II division, which was making all the money, shipping Apple II. There was the Macintosh division, which was not shipping, and it was spending all the money. But we were such bad people in the Macintosh division, we would not let Apple II division employees into the building. And so they came up with a very good joke about us, which is, how many Macintosh division employees does it take to screw in a light bulb? The answer is one. The Macintosh division employee holds up the light bulb and expects the universe to revolve around him. There's a Microsoft version. How many of you use Macintoshes in this audience? Oh, all of you. How many of you use Windows? Oh, that's too bad. So the Microsoft version of this joke is, how many Microsoft employees does it take to screw in a light bulb? And the answer is none, because Bill Gates has declared darkness the new standard. I'm going to talk to you today about the lessons that I learned from Steve Jobs. But first, I want to show you a few pictures, because this is my first campus party. I've never been to anything like this, okay? Yeah. So my first picture, I have been to many conferences all over the world. I just came from a Wikipedia conference in Italy where we took over a village. And I thought that was neat, but I have never, ever seen anything like this. This is utterly fantastic. So this is how you sleep? Yeah? And this is how you brush your teeth? Yeah? And this is how you take a shower? Yeah? This is where I slept last night. No. That's why I'm sore today. This whole thing is utterly, utterly fantastic. I've never, ever seen anything like it. So thank you very much for inviting me. And then I learned about a new business model. So this business model apparently is that you program for food. I'm going to take this back to Silicon Valley, and we're going to put this in the business plan. Program for food. I love this. This is my favorite picture of the entire conference, where I learned to program for pizza. So I'm going to use a top 10 format to explain the top 10 lessons that I learned from Steve Jobs, okay? Because I think that what Steve Jobs did can be applied to your careers, to your companies, to your ideas. There's lots of things to learn from Steve Jobs that are very valuable for you. The first thing that I learned from Steve is that customers cannot tell you what they need. They can only tell you what they want in terms of what they already know. So if you are Apple, they will tell you that they want a bigger, faster, cheaper Apple II. Because that's all they know from you, an Apple II. But in fact, what I learned from Steve is that there are times where you cannot listen to your customers, and you have to anticipate what they will need before even they know that they need it. And that led to Macintosh. Macintosh was not at all what Apple II customers wanted. Apple II customers wanted a better Apple II. Nobody was asking for a Macintosh. Lesson number one, customers cannot tell you what they need. Lesson number two is that great innovation happens on the next curve, not the curve that you're on. This example is from the ice business. There used to be an ice harvesting business in the United States. In the late 1800s, early 1900s, people would harvest blocks of ice. So it had to be the winter. You had a horse, a saw, and a sleigh, and you cut blocks of ice. This was ice 1.0, 1900. 30 years go by, and now we have ice 2.0. Now you freeze water in an ice factory. This is much better than harvesting ice because it doesn't have to be winter. You don't have to go to a lake or a pond. You can freeze water in any city, any time of year. Much better technology. Another 30 years go by, and now we have the refrigerator curve. And on the refrigerator curve, now everybody has their own ice factory. It's in their house. It's a refrigerator. And if you look at this transition from ice harvesting to ice factory, to refrigerator, you see that great progress is made on the next curve. It's not by building a better sleigh. It's not by building a better ice factory. It's not by building a better refrigerator. You have to get to the next curve. The great innovation occurs when you jump to the next curve, not when you fight it out on the same curve. So you, as entrepreneurs and engineers and tech people, you have got to get to the next curve. If you want to change the world, get to the next curve. The third thing that I learned from Steve is that design counts. This is a picture of a MacBook Air. Design counts. Not everybody appreciates great design, but enough people appreciate great design. This is a MacBook Air. It is cool. It is thin. It is beautiful. It looks like a Tibetan monk carved it from a solid block of aluminum. It is design. Design counts. The fourth thing that I learned from Steve is that if you truly want to motivate yourself, if you truly want to motivate the people you work with, you have to give them big challenges. You know, when Steve motivated us for Macintosh, he didn't say, we need to ship another personal computer. Steve's challenge to us was that we needed to ship Macintosh to prevent worldwide domination by IBM. That we had to prevent the end of free thinking, that we had to preserve democracy. That's how we position creating Macintosh. This is my favorite picture of Steve Jobs. This is Steve Jobs giving IBM the finger. This is a great picture. By the way, while we're on this topic about giving people the finger, I want to tell you that I, as an American, I want to apologize to all of you for Donald Trump, okay? I don't care if you learn anything else from me. I want you to know that very few people in America agree with Donald Trump. He is an embarrassment to America, okay? Just write that down, tweet that. You can quote me. I am apologizing for Donald Trump to all of you, all of Mexico, really. Next topic. The next thing that I learned from Steve is that less is more. And I'll show you a very good example. This is a Steve Jobs slide. If you look at this slide, you see one big graphic. You see the word iTunes. iTunes is in about a 200-point font. And then you see the best Windows app ever written. So that is 7 words on that slide. 7 words on that slide. And what I learned from Steve is that in packaging, in marketing, in design, in slides, less is more. As an entrepreneur, if you need to pitch your company, I suggest you use the 10-20-30 rule, which is 10 slides, 20 minutes, 30-point font, minimum size font, 30 points, all right? Steve Jobs is better than all of us. He can do it in 7 words, 200-point font, 10 slides, 20 minutes, 30-point font. Now, by contrast, this is a Steve Jobs slide, okay? This is a Bill Gates slide. Which slide do you think is more effective? Now, clearly, Bill Gates was very successful. Steve Jobs was very successful. So I'm not telling you that you cannot be successful with an ugly slide like this. You can be successful with an ugly slide like this. But with an ugly slide like this, you have to overcome the slide. Less is more. Number six, I learned is that changing your mind is really a sign of intelligence. Many people believe that changing your mind is a sign of stupidity. It is a sign of weakness. They are wrong. Changing your mind is a sign of intelligence. Let me show you an Apple example. When the iPhone was introduced, this is the slide that was used. Our innovative approach using Web 2.0-based standards lets developers create amazing new applications while keeping the iPhone secure and reliable. Introduction of iPhone. What that slide is saying is no external applications. If you want to add functionality to the iPhone, you have to write a Safari plugin. That's what that slide says. A year goes by. Apple executives to showcase Mac OS X Leopard and OS X iPhone development platforms at WWDC 2008 keynote. Let me tell you what this slide says. This slide says, we're opening up the iPhone. Now you can write native iOS apps. So we have gone from completely closed, you only can write Safari plugin, to completely open. You can write native iOS apps. This is a 180-degree shift. Steve realized that he was wrong in 2007 to close the iPhone. He opened it up a year later. This is an example of intelligence. When you are wrong, when there is a better way, admit it and get on with it. Don't deny it. Don't resist it. Because changing your mind is a sign of intelligence. Number seven really applies to you because many of you are engineering students. Number seven is that engineers are artists. Programming is an art. It is not labor. It is not a science. It is an art. It is no different than writing, painting, sculpting. It is an art. This is one of the Macintosh artists. This is Burl Smith. He created much of the Macintosh analog hardware design. He was an artist. So those of you who are engineers, from this day forth, I want you to consider yourself as an artist. That's what you do. It is an art. Number 8 is that marketing is all about unique value. This is the only slide you ever need to understand to be a great marketer. You never have to take a marketing class. You never have to get an advanced degree. This is it, this slide. Okay, so we have 2 axes. On the vertical axis, we measure uniqueness. On the horizontal axis, we measure value. Okay? This is a 2x2 matrix. There's going to be 4 cells. In the bottom right corner, you have something that is valuable, but it is not unique. In that corner, you always have to compete on price. You can be Michael Dell in that corner, right? You create this thing, this clone. It's the same operating system on the same hardware. You can make billions of dollars there. Michael Dell did that. But it's all about price because you have the same operating system on the same hardware. You can be successful there, but it is always about price. In the opposite corner, in this corner, you have something that is unique. Only you do it, but it is not valuable. In that corner, you are just plain stupid. This is the corner where you have made something that nobody cares about, that nobody uses. It is of no use, but only you do it. The next corner is even worse. In the bottom left corner, that's where you have something that is not unique and not valuable. The worst corner of all. Those things are dog bones because America had a great example of dog food, selling dog food online. It was a company called Pets.com. So let me give you the Silicon Valley pitch for Pets.com. There are 300 million Americans. 1 in 4 owns a dog. That's 75 million dogs. Each dog eats 2 cans of dog food per day. That's a total addressable market of 150 million cans of dog food per day. You take 150 million cans of dog food per day and you multiply it by 365, because dogs eat every day. They don't take the weekend off. This is not B2B. This is B2C. Or really, it's B2D. So dogs eat every day. You take 150 million, you multiply by 365. My God, what a humongous market there is for dog food. The problem with dog food online is that, yes, you can eliminate the dog food store to give people a discount, but then you have to add back shipping and handling. Otherwise, the dog food is still in your warehouse. So yes, you take away and give a discount because it's not a retail store, but then you have to add back shipping and handling. Effectively, the price is the same. And then somebody had to be at home when the dog food was delivered. So it was less convenient and just as expensive. Therefore, it wasn't valuable. It wasn't unique because so many venture capital firms fell for the pitch. They believed that 150 million cans of dog food were being sold every day, 365 days a year. So there was Pets.com, MyPets.com, ePets.com, LastMinutePets.com. There were 10 ways to buy dog food online. This is the worst corner of all, because in that corner, you are not unique and you are not valuable. So the corner you want to be in, the only marketing you ever need, this is all you need, I promise you. If you get this right, you get marketing right, you need to be in that corner. In that corner, you are unique and valuable. Apple is unique and valuable. When Apple first came out with the iPod, It was unique and valuable. It was the only way you could legally buy music for 99 cents per song easily. It was the only way you had a device that was easy to navigate, too easy to use. It was unique and valuable. And so what I've learned over 40 years in management, all of marketing comes down to this. So if you're an engineer, you need to make some software that is unique and valuable. If you're a marketeer, you need to convince the world that your software, that your hardware, that your product is unique and valuable. This is the holy grail of marketing. You should spend a lot of time thinking about how your product is unique and valuable. Number nine is that entrepreneurs and innovators and revolutionaries, they ignore naysayers. They ignore people who are negative. They ignore people who tell you it can't be done, it shouldn't be done, and it isn't necessary. Now, I call naysayers bozos, like Bozo the Clown. And so I call what they do bozosity. So you need to learn to ignore bozosity and naysaying and negativity if you want to succeed. Now, there are two kinds of bozos in the world. One bozo is clearly a loser. This bozo is driving a rusty car, Japanese watch, body odor, pocket protector, just a disgusting person. This bozo is not dangerous. Because you look at this person, and it's clear this person is a loser. And only a loser would listen to a loser, right? So if you're not a loser, you don't have to be afraid of the loser bozo. It's the winner bozo that's dangerous. Because the winner bozo, you're tempted to listen to. Because the winner bozo is rich and famous and powerful. The winner bozo dresses in all black. The winner bozo owns a lot of things that end in I, like Armani, Ferrari, Lamborghini, Maserati. Audi is okay. Audi is an exception. Okay? So you look at that person, dressed in all black, Armani, driving a Ferrari, and you think rich and famous equals smart. And I will tell you, half the time, rich and famous equals lucky, not smart. And so I believe that bozosity is like the flu. How do you get rid of the flu? How do you prevent the flu? You take a shot. What is a flu shot? A flu shot is a little bit of flu to prevent you from having the major flu, right? You get a little bit of flu to create resistance to major flu. Bozosity is the same thing. So I'm going to give you some examples of bozosity so that when you encounter bozosity, you will have built up the resistance. So when somebody tells you it can't be done, it shouldn't be done, it isn't necessary, you will have the intellectual ability, the intellectual strength, the intellectual resistance to ignore the bozo. I think there is a world market for maybe 5 computers. Thomas Watson, chairman of IBM, allegedly said this in 1943. 5 computers in the world. I have 5 Macintoshes in my house. I have all the computers he anticipated in the world in my house. This telephone has too many shortcomings to be seriously considered as a means of communication. The device is inherently of no value to us. Western Union internal memo, right? So Western Union wrote off telephony. Western Union still exists today. It's still successful. But Western Union could have been PayPal. It could have been Square. It could have been Bitcoin. It could have been all these things. But it had to get to the next curve. Next example, there is no reason why anyone would want a computer in their home. Ken Olson, the founder of DEC, said this. DEC was a fantastic company. mini computer, very successful. Ken Olson was a great entrepreneur, a great innovator, but he was so successful on the mini computer curve, he could not embrace the personal computer curve. Imagine if you owned a lot of ice factories. Imagine if you were very successful with ice factories. And somebody said, we have a new way of freezing water. It's called a refrigerator. And you could have a refrigerator in any house. The ice factory owner would say, why would anybody want a refrigerator in a house? All they have to do is send me a telegram and I will deliver ice to their house from my ice factory. This is bozosity. So when you encounter people who tell you it can't be done and it shouldn't be done and it isn't necessary, remember that the founder of IBM said five computers. Western Union said that telephones will never succeed. Ken Olson said that no one will want a computer in their house. Just remember that. I have prevented you from succumbing to naysayers and stupidity and negativity and bozosity. My 10th thing that I learned from Steve is that some things need to be believed to be seen. Skeptics will tell you some things need to be seen to be believed. I'll believe it when I see it. But I will tell you that innovators and revolutionaries and entrepreneurs, they have the opposite attitude. They understand that if you believe it, you will see it. Not if you see it, then you believe it. So I'm going to show you something. This is an analysis of the success and failures and to be determined of Apple Computer. In the success column, Apple I, Apple II, Macintosh, iPod, iPhone, Apple Store, and iPad. All successful. One thing you should know, when Apple first came out with the Apple Store, every retail expert in the world said there is no freaking way that an Apple store would succeed. There is no way that Apple can get the kind of sales volume for just one product line from a retail store. It cannot pay shopping center prices. It cannot pay for a store in Manhattan, smack dab in the middle of the most expensive real estate in the world. It cannot be. Those are the successes, the failures. Apple III, Lisa, Newton, Apple TV. To be determined, Apple Watch. So I put this slide up for you so that you understand that even Apple, the company that everybody holds up as this fantastic, successful, innovative, entrepreneurial thing, even Apple fails roughly 50% of the time. It's okay. You know what the opposite of success is? Many people believe that the opposite of success is failure. Not if you're an entrepreneur. The opposite of success, if you're an entrepreneur, is your learning. As long as you're learning, you're not failing. Some things need to be seen to be believed, but most things in entrepreneurship need to be believed to be seen. And if you believed in Apple, and if you believed in Macintosh, and iPhone, and iPod, and iPad, you would end up with the first $700 billion company. Apple is truly proof that some things need to be believed to be seen. And now, I am going to ask you for a favor, because I am the chief evangelist of a company called Canva. How many of you already use Canva by any chance? So good. So Canva, roughly the same number who use Macintoshes. So Canva is an online graphics design service. And with Canva, you can create just beautiful social media graphics, email headers, presentations, ads, book covers. So I want you to do me a favor, and I want you to all try Canva, okay? C-A-N-V-A. I'm just asking you for this favor, and I'm going to give you something. I'm going to give you a promo code. So if you go to this website, you will have the ability. Everybody raises up their Samsungs right now. You'll have the ability to get 182 pesos or $10 of credit for Canva. Most of Canva is free, but there will be times where you use stock photos and they are a dollar each. I just made it so you can do this 10 times for free. So check this out. End of commercial for my company. Try Canva, please. The bottom line with Steve Jobs. Well, let me tell you a story so you understand Steve, because everybody wants one Steve Jobs story. So one day, I'm in my cubicle, and I'm working, and Steve Jobs shows up with somebody that I have never met before. And he says to me, "Guy, what do you think of this company called Knoware, K-N-O-W-A-R-E? It was an educational software company, knowledge software." And so I said, "Well, Steve, to tell you the truth, the company is mediocre. The product is mediocre. It is drill and practice. It doesn't take very good advantage of color or graphics. It doesn't have very sophisticated logic. Drill and practice, easy mathematical things. It is not a product that is crucial for Macintosh." Okay? So I tell Steve and this stranger this. And then Steve says to me, "Guy, I want you to meet the CEO of Knoware." That's what it was like working for Steve Jobs. You know, I would not be where I am today without Steve Jobs. He was a turning point in my career. I owe a lot to Steve Jobs. He was a fantastic, though difficult, person to work for. It wasn't easy working for him. But of all the people who worked in the Macintosh division and Apple in the next few years, nobody would say they would trade that experience for anything. It was a fantastic experience. He died several years ago. I can tell you right now that the world is a lot less interesting without Steve Jobs. I tried to bring some of his lessons back for you. But I can tell you one more thing. Steve Jobs right now is telling God what to do. And so if you don't like Universe 1.0, Universe 2.0 is coming, designed by Steve Jobs. And I hope that you could take some of these lessons and apply it to the companies and the products that you're creating. You are the future. I hate to say, I love to say, you are the future. And you're going to indulge me in one more thing. I am going to take a video, because it is not that often that I speak to an audience like this. So I'm going to take a video that goes all the way over here, okay? So we could say this would be the largest selfie ever. But anyway, so everybody say hi over here. All right, all right. All righty. And what I'm going to do with this is I'm going to send it to Donald Trump. Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Do you want to make question and answers? Do you want to make question and answers?
Oh, we have time? Yes. Q&A, I'm not done, I guess. Okay.
Mr. Guy, do you want to throw it? Or do you
what
want
is
me
it?
To give it?
How does it work?
It's the mic.
This so is the this is the microphone? I see. I see a guy over there. Here you go.
Hi, Guy. One simple
question.
That's
very clever. I've never seen that either.
Yeah?
I learned a lot in Mexico.
Hi, Guy. One simple question. Why do you think it's important to find the correct mentor in your entrepreneur career?
Well, why it's important to find the right mentor is because a mentor can save you from making stupid mistakes. And there are a lot of stupid mistakes. And if nothing else, a mentor can at least help you make new mistakes that nobody else has made. So, if you can find a mentor. Now, I'm not saying that 3,000 of you should ask me to be a mentor, okay? Because I don't scale. But, yeah, mentor can be very valuable.
Thank you.
All right. What else? There's a baby over there, yeah. Where? Oh, that's close. That's the difference between me and LeBron James.
Hi, guy. What do you think? The Apple TV was a failure. I think it's a good product. And I saw it in your slide.
Wait, I'm sorry. I couldn't understand.
What do you think? The Apple TV was a failure product.
Oh, so why do I think Apple TV is a failure? Because it maybe to be more fair, it's to be determined, but it has not reached critical mass. How many of you use Apple TV? How many of you use, what else is there really, right? What's the Google thing? How many of you use that? Oh, maybe Apple TV is a success, hey. Yeah. I tried to use Apple TV. I don't know, video is so messed up, right? So you have, I'm a Comcast customer. I'm very happy with Comcast, except Comcast doesn't give me, they don't have deals with some of the subscriptions, right? So I can't watch Orange is the New Black or House of Cards. I thought of a great joke. So, you know how Donald Trump always has he looks like he's covered with Cheetos? He's orange. So, if Donald Trump wins, we're gonna go from black to orange, like Obama's black. So it could be that orange is gonna be the new black, right? Okay, over here. No? I'll hand it to you.
Okay. You have to answer quickly, okay?
Okay.
The first word that you see when I say Samsung.
Okay. When you say what?
Samsung.
Samsung? Fingerprints. You know why?
Why?
Okay, so the word is Samsung, and my first word is fingerprints, because on the Samsung S7 and F7 Edge, the back side, when you hold it, it picks up all your fingerprints. So. Why? Do you work for Samsung?
No. I use Apple. Here's my iPhone.
Yeah, look at all the fingerprints.
No,
it's an Apple. So why did you ask me about Samsung?
Because it's the bad guy for you.
Oh, no. Okay, how about one last question? Here you go.
Thank you. What's your take on, I remember I read the biography of Steve Jobs, and he talked a lot about the walking conversations he had. It was like a big deal.
So what I think of that?
Yeah, what's your
take?
Okay,
so what he's referring to is that Steve had this habit of, he would take you out or tell you, let's go for a walk. And then you would walk around the neighborhood or you walk around the building. And it's usually because he wanted to convince you to do something that you didn't want to do. And so he took you on this walk and he tried to convince you to do something you didn't want to do. And then if you didn't agree by the end of the walk, you got fired. This is a dangerous walk. So let's just say that everything you've heard about human relations and good employee practices and all that kind of stuff, Steve Jobs did none of that. He was an HR nightmare. There was a time that, when there were division meetings and everybody was in the audience, he would not hesitate at all. I'll pretend I'm Steve Jobs. You are a bozo. Okay? You're a loser.
Definitely.
You're a lousy employee.
I am.
Okay? So this is what Steve Jobs would do. Let's pretend that she's in charge of hiring. Okay? So this is now, everybody's in the meeting. Why is he here? Who hired him? Why is that shit employee still in this division? And this is in front of everybody. And, you know, you may think that that's really harsh. It actually is kind of harsh. But I'll tell you something. It was a great motivation. Because you never, ever wanted to be humiliated like that. So, you know, all these theories of HR that you should be kind and gentle and you should meet with your employees and develop mutually acceptable goals and you provide positive feedback, accentuating what's done right, minimizing what's done wrong. I can also tell you that fear of humiliation is a very powerful motivating force. So I'm not suggesting that you do that when you have companies, but it can work. Okay? All right. I got to go. Thank you very much.